المسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. وبعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، فيقول الله سبحانه وتعالى: والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. Brothers, can you make sure please that when you come close to the Imam, because you'll get more thawab and then this hall will get crowded, so people don't have to jump over your shoulders. جزاكم الله خير. When you want to leave, you can leave, whether you are two row behind or two row in front. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. من إعجاز القرآن, one of the characteristics of Al-Quran and that makes it a miracle is that a few words can suffice for gigantic amount of meanings. Oftentimes you read two ayat, and if you just do these two ayat in your life, by the will of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide you. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ أُولَئِكَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا جَزَاءً بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Two ayat in Surah Al-Ahqaf. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ So those who قَالُوا إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهِ They said Allah is our Lord is Allah. ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا And they followed the straight path. فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ There is no fear that for what they face for their future, nor would they grieve for what they left behind. أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ Those are the companions of Al-Jannah, abiding there forever as a reward for their good deeds. That's, if you read these two ayat, dear brothers and sisters, you'll find that this is sufficient, because it gives you all the conditions that you'll go to Jannah and abide there forever. If you study that, you'll find it in these two ayat, and you can say that about Al-Quran in general. Surah Al-Asr, which is one of the shortest surahs in Al-Quran, it is the second shortest surah after Surah Al-Kawthar. إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ. And Surah Al-Asr, والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر is also three ayat, and from language viewpoint it is indeed as one sentence. Apart from the oath والعصر, you'll find that the rest of the surah is one sentence. And yet الشافعي rahimahullah, says, لو ما أنزل الله حجة على خلقه إلا هذه السورة لكفتهم. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only thing He revealed to humankind, this surah, it would have been sufficient for them. And also He says, لو تدبر الناس هذه السورة لوسعتهم. If they contemplate in this surah, it would have entailed them. It will have entailed all what they need in their lives. So what is the meanings of Surah Al-Asr? Well, Asr is an oath, dear brothers and sisters, by the time indeed man is in loss. So it starts with an oath, and then it says that man is in a state of loss. And then it makes an exception for those who have believed and do righteous deeds and join together in the mutual enjoining of truth and join together in the mutual enjoining of patience. So that is Surah Al-Asr. Wal-Asr. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. And I'm sure, inshallah, a lot of you know it by heart. So let us shed some lights and try to understand this surah in the next a few minutes. So the first part of the surah is Wal Asr, and it is an oath. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an oath. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an oath, then it is an oath by something extremely important. And also what comes after the oath needs our full attention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an oath with what He wills in His creation, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ كَلَّا وَالْقَمَرِ, and so on. You will find it is spread in Al-Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an oath with His creation. Nevertheless, for us, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned us, مَنْ كَانَ مَنْ أَقْسَمَ فَلْيُقْسِمْ بِاللَّهِ أَوْ لِيَصْمِتْ. Whoever makes an oath, he should make an oath by Allah, or should keep quiet. We are not allowed, because when you make an oath with something, then you give it its holy status, and that only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not make an oath by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nor do we make an oath by Al-Ka'ba or anything else. We only make an oath by Allah. We say Wallahi, Tallahi, Billahi, Wa Rabbi Al-Ka'ba, which means the Lord of Al-Ka'ba, and so on. What is Al-Asr? Al-Asr, it means many things in the Arabic language. And usually if you really want to understand a word in Arabic, you have to go to the root of it. And the root of the word Al-Asr is from three letters, the Ayn and the Sad and the Ra, Asr. And it means so many things. It means to squeeze something out of its juice. Well, Asr, it means the time. It means the time of Al-Asr, which is later on in the day. And also derived from Al-Asr is Al-I'sar, which is the hurricane, which is very fast, and it passes by and it causes destruction. For sure, Wal-Asr is the time, and the time that affects all of us, dear brothers and sisters. The time is part of us, and we lose it all the time. Wal-Asr. So, this moment will never come back. This second will be will be gone, and then the next second comes, and the next minute, and the next hour, and the next day. Once the day is over, it's never coming back. So time is moving on, and in the surah, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ الْمُقْسَمْ عَلَيْهِ. So Allah makes an oath by Al-Asr to say that Al-Insan, you'll find in some translations, in some of the translation of Al-Quran Al-Kareem, it translated by the man. And what they mean, the man, is the human. Because Al-Insan, in Arabic language, reflects the human, man and woman, believer or otherwise. It entails all the human beings. And it says that everyone is in a state of loss. And the word fi means in Arabic. So it is a state of loss that affects everybody. And if you think about it, life is moving on, it's passing us by. To achieve something, if you want to study, you need time. You go and you spend 3-4 years at the university. If you are a professional, you will spend a few hours a day doing a job. So you are spending your time. If you are cooking, you stand for an hour or so to cook. And that is time used to produce a dish. And the same if you go shopping, the mother looks after her kids, and it takes time. Pregnancy is 9 months. Breastfeeding could be up to 2 years. It's all time. And it's time spent and never comes back. So if you think of the time as the capital we have, then all the time, on a daily basis, we are and we have to invest that capital somehow. We invest it or we lose it. A day is gone. What you have done with that day, it depends, but it's gone. Have you been righteous? Have you been good? Have you looked after your kids? Have you went about your life in an honest way according to the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? Or that time have been wasted somewhat? So the loss is continuous. It is a state of continuous loss for everyone, but with an exception. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. By the way, just to go back to Al-Asr, in Arabic you say Al-Usur al-Sabiqa, the previous nations, the previous time. So also it indicates a testimonial, because an oath also is done for a testimony, to say that look at the previous nations. Look what they have left and where are they? What they have done? Have they lost or have they done something else? So there is also that element of looking back into time and looking at nations and how they perished and how they, some of them they were punished and some of them they continued as kingdoms and nations for centuries and then they disappeared. So Al-Asr is that time, and it reflects that there is a state of loss for individuals, for groups, and even for nations. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an exception. And if you when you make an exception, we say every rule has got an exception. Generally, the exception is a minority subset of the rule. So the exception or the accepted is always lesser in volume or number than what you accepted it from. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Also, let us just one thing before we move on. Also, Al-Asr, some Mufassirun, they said that it is the time of Al-Asr. And the time of Al-Asr is the tailing end of the day. It is towards the end of the day. And once Al-Asr kicks in, the time of afternoon, or the time of Salatul Asr, then time moves, seems to be moving quickly. You say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and before you know it, sunset is there, and the day is over. So also, the oath by Al-Asr is different, for example, by the oath of Al-Fajr. Because Al-Fajr is dawn time, is the beginning of the day. There is plenty of time still. But Al-Asr, it means that there isn't much left. And it can be in a negative way, but it can also be in a positive way. In a negative way, that it is no much time left and it needs to be looked at and cared for. So be careful. And actually, this ummah, the Prophet ﷺ says, "Bu'ithtu ana wa sa'a kahatayn." I was sent and the hour, which is the day of the doomsday of the Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day of judgment, is like this. So we are the last ummah, and we are towards the end of time. And that is very similar to the time of Al-Asr, the time of the afternoon. But also, from a positive sense, it means that although it is Al-Asr and not much time left, but you still can make use of it. If you think you are 25 and you may have not done much in the last 25 years, and believe me, I have students coming to me, say, I'm 25, I wasted a lot of time. What have I achieved? So they are looking at what they have lost. They are not looking at what they have still in front of them. Maybe another 30, 40, 50 years. Whatever stage you are in today, if you are 60 or 70 or 50 or 30 or 15, remember you still have time to join those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted from the losers. You still have that chance. Don't say, I have done nothing, I wasted my... Well, if still you are breathing in and breathing out, alhamdulillah, still alive, you have that chance. So let us look into that exception. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Except for those who believed and do righteous deeds. Now, if you read in Al-Quran, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ is always bundled together. Iman and good deeds, they come together. Because Iman, as defined by the scholars of Islam, مَا وَقَرَ فِي الْقَلْبِ وَصَدَّقَهُ الْعَمَلِ. What resides in your heart and it is manifested in your deeds. And some say, إيمان بالجنان وقول باللسان وعمل بالأركان. It is a belief in your heart and it is reflected in what you say. When you say, لا إله إلا الله, it is a reflection of your iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in the day of judgment and the angels and the prophets and the books and the fate. خيره وشر, good and bad. So you believe and then you say it and then it is manifested in the way you do. You establish salah, you pay zakah, you are good to your parents, you look after your family, you are kind to your wife and you look after your husband. You raise up your children according to Islam, you are kind to your neighbors, you are honest at work, and so on. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And that theme is extensive in the holy book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Quran. But in this surah, subhanallah, it doesn't come on its own. So al-Iman, we know what is al-Iman. And عَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ, it is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires from us in terms of deeds, good deeds, from the five pillars of Islam to the rest of our duties towards ourselves, towards one another, towards our society, towards our community, towards the wife and the children and the husband and the parents, all of that. عَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ, after the iman, that is in the Quran, but in this surah it requires something extra. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ is that they join together in the mutual enjoining of truth. And something else, but let us look at this. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. Not only that you believe, not only that you act according to your belief, but also you remind one another that you should continue to do that. It is the correction element within the deen of this ummah. الْأَمْرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّهِي عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, to enjoin good and forbid evil. That is the stabilizing element of Islam. Otherwise, subhanAllah, sometimes, you know, you look and it's been 1400 years and you're still praying Asr for rak'ah and Fajr to rak'ah. And the time, no one can deny the time. And the number of sunan and the way we do siyam and the hajj, etc., has not changed. Thus, and if you look at other nations before us, I talked to a reverend, a friend of mine at the university. I said, how come? I said, Ramadan, as you know, it moves on because it follows a lunar year, a lunar month in a year. How come you always fast in the Lent in April or around that time? And also the fasting is becoming like, you know, I give up chocolate, I give up looking at football and all. Said, you know, is this really? He said, look, fasting is like what you do. That is the fasting. And also, it used to be Amr bil ma'ruf wa nahi anil munkar, to enjoin good and forbid evil. That is the stabilizing element of Islam. Otherwise, subhanAllah, sometimes, you know, you look and it's been 1400 years and you're still praying Asr for rak'ah and Fajr to rak'ah. And the time, no one can deny the time. And the number of sunan and the way we do siyam and the hajj, etc., has not changed. Thus, and if you look at other nations before us, I talked to a reverend, a friend of mine at the university. I said, how come? I said, Ramadan, as you know, it moves on because it follows a lunar year, a lunar month in a year. How come you always fast in the Lent in April or around that time? And also the fasting is becoming like, you know, I give up chocolate, I give up looking at football and all. Said, you know, is this really? He said, look, fasting is like what you do. That is the fasting. And also it used to be following a lunar month. So it moved. But at some stage in history, the history of Christianity, they decided to fix it. It's like saying, you know, guys, you know, sometimes Ramadan is in June and then it moves on to May and it moves on to April. I'll tell you what, you know, April, March is a nice time. The day is not too long, is not too short, it's not too hot, it's not too... Shall we agree to have Ramadan in April? Shall we make it just 12 hours from that to that? Alhamdulillah, until today, with all what we say about this ummah, with all the weaknesses we can pick up, alhamdulillah, the deen is intact, dear brothers and sisters, because of وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Because we enjoin good and forbid evil. If that happens, people will deny it. Say, no, no good. If a scholar comes up with a strange opinion, people will go against it. Some will follow, but eventually it will die off and it will die away. وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالْحَقِّ. That is تَوَاصَوْ بِالْحَقِّ. What about تَوَاصَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ, dear brothers and sisters? All of that. Particularly that part of تَوَاصَوْ بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ. I stand in front of you like a member of this community. It's just an extra duty I have to do. And I remind you, and then sometimes someone say, you know, so and so, he incites hatred. Because I told people that, you know, this cannot be done, or this can be done. People, of course, alhamdulillah, that doesn't happen very often, but it happens. It happens that you go to someone and say, you know, brother, you are a very good brother, mashallah, but you don't establish salah. Mashallah, Allah gives you health, Allah gives you wealth, you have knowledge, you are a lawyer, you are a doctor, and, you know, people look up at you, and you have kids now. Why don't you establish salah? Of course, I mean, the general reaction, say, you know, make dua for me, brother. I am this, I am that, I am weak, but the brother knows. But sometimes he comes and say, it's none of your business. What do you think you are? You know what? I don't need to hear that from you. So you, and that is what the prophets faced, didn't they? They came with the truth. They came to tell people, this is the path of Allah. This leads to Jannah and elsewhere. It leads to a vile life and hellfire, walayyadu billah, towards the end. And they went against them. We know that. So sabr, patience, is part of this deen. And it's definitely required to be patient with your iman, to be patient with establishing Islam in your life, and to be patient when enjoining good and forbidding evil. Because you will face resistance, and sometimes your own parents. So what happens to you? Why you are like that? It's just because you are a more dedicated person. They find it's a different person that they knew before, and they themselves, instead of encouraging you, they will start to put pressure upon you. And I think that happens to a lot of us. And it will continue to happen, sometimes out of good heart, but it does happen, and you need patience for it. Generally, just to seal, dear brothers and sisters, sabr is required for as-sabr an ma'asi Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be patient, not to indulge in what bring the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. There are lots and lots of temptations here and everywhere, dear brothers and sisters. And you need to have that patience, say, no, it is haram. Maybe it is something nice for a few minutes, or for half an hour or so, but then the result is sorrow, the result is the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the result that it eats into my deen, and it makes me a worse person. So you need to have patience, and also to have patience to establish salah. Yes, you are extremely tired. You'd rather slept until 7:30 or 8, but you need to get up by 5:30 or 6 o'clock to do Fajr. It needs patience. It needs patience to have Siyam for sure. You have 100,000 pounds and you need to pay Zakat. You say, you know, I need to pay 2,500 pounds, which is, if you think about 2,500 pounds, within 100,000 is nothing. But still, for some people, it needs some willpower to do it. And also, dear brothers and sisters, to have patience in whatever happens to us. We may be tested by loss of life, loss of health, loss of wealth. Something happens around us, to us, or the people we love around us, and we need to say, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. We need to be patient. We need to accept that. أقول هذا القول وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. Dear brothers and sisters, Islam redefines a lot of terms, and one of them is the term of success and loss. You may look at someone in the past or in the present, say, MashaAllah, this person is very successful. But if you use the tools of Islam, Al-Quran and Al-Sunnah, if you use Surah Al-Asr as of course, we need to use it upon ourselves, but it's just an exercise to say that Islam redefines the success and failure. For sure, Surah Al-Asr redefines that and says that all is in loss, but apart from those who believe and do righteous deeds and enjoy good together. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ, and also remind one another for as-sabr. So we need to really remember that. And last thing I want to say that كَانَ الرَّجُلَانِ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِذَا الْتَقَيَا لَمْ يَفْتَرِقَا حَتَّى يَقْرَأَ أَحَدُهُمَا عَلَى الْآخَرِ وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ ثُمَّ يُسَلِّمُ أَحَدُهُمَا عَلَى الْآخَرِ. صححه الألباني في السلسلة الصحيحة والطبراني في الأوسط. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum realized the power of this surah, and they used to, when they get together, of course there are some dua of when you leave, subhanakallah wa hamdik, etc. There are duas that to leave a gathering so as Allah will forgive your sins. And also the Sahaba used to read Surah Al-Asr to one another before they depart, and then they say assalamu alaikum and they go, as if they are reminding one another of the way not to be a loser, of a way to join those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an exception for those who believe, do righteous deeds, enjoin one another with truth, and enjoin one another with patience. أسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يجعلنا ممن يؤمنون بالله ويعملون الصالحات ويتواصوا بالحق ويتواصوا بالصبر. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه, وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم اغفر وارحم وتجاوز عما تعلم, إنك أنت العز الأكرم. اللهم ارحمنا فإنك بنا راحم, والطف بنا بما جرت به المقادير. Can I just remind you brothers, that when you come and you are late, don't block the entrance. If you can come to the other end, we still have that stage. It can take a few people. So if you can really do that, it would be good. جزاكم الله خير. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة.